get it force in effect. It's time for TK 170 Boogie Down Bronx, man. Wild style all the way. What's up,
yo? Yo, thank you very much, man. Thank you for taking time.
So I over here,
thank you
for
not chopping me up in tiny little pieces.
Hey, listen, man. You know, the saw wasn't working right now. I think I didn't have no gas for the chainsaw, man. You know? Shit, nah, that was cool, man.
I'll let you know later what that joke was about.
Yeah. Now, homeboy came out to my studio, man. It's out in the horse ranch, and, you know. And it was kind of late, because homeboy was coming from, I don't know where, but fuck down south somewhere.
No, I was in Rhode Island.
Rhode Island? Oh, yeah, I was coming from the north.
I was handling a gig out in Rhode Island.
So it was kind of dark, so, you know, my studio is in a horse ranch, you know. And it's cool, man, because it's inexpensive, and it's a great spot, man. You know, so, you know. You know, we met at the condo first, but you know, we had to drive to the back there and whatnot, and you know.
He goes, yo, still, this guy, he's like 6'4 over me. He goes, I'm walking slow behind him, and it just felt forever like walking into the woods.
Yeah.
Into the forest.
Nah, it was a drive.
He said, I don't know if you're gonna murder me, you're gonna kill me back there, or do graffiti. Yeah.
And we ended up doing graffiti.
The studio was hot. It was a nice studio. A lot of stuff in there. You could tell the talent. So really, you know, Terrible Kid. I know Terrible Kid because I'm from. I used to hang out in Poe Park. I went to John F. Kennedy. I went to Roosevelt High School. I was around that. So I saw the writings, you know, on the walls. I saw the trains and all that. And at first I'm like, who the hell's trying to be Kid T? And it's all us. That's Terrible. Terrible Kid, oh, fuck him. You know? Because I was Kid Terrific, you know? Right. And so, you know, fast forward, I never met you back in those days. So fast forward, I started seeing some of the stuff that you were doing online, and that's when I reached out to you. I'm like, yo, I like the work that you do. Can you do something for me? Which you did. And it was awesome, bro. It was fucking awesome. I liked it. And I said, yo, can you come down? You know, I know my brother right here wants to do some work around the studio here.
Right.
And, I wanted to interview because you bring something different to hip hop, as far as I can see. Because a lot of hip hop is focused on just like on Zulu and that kind of crowd. But I know that it goes
way before that, man. You know, you gotta understand, man. You know, I'm like, when breakdancing started, I was like one of the first breakdancers. Okay, there were no power moves. Okay, in fact, I invented the helicopter. That was my move, and humping the floor. You know, so people don't know that shit about me. So, you know.
So you used to break that.
I used to break that. When it first started.
That's why we do this. You know why we do this? Listen, the whole purpose of the show when we started this, especially me, I have a thing where I've always said, all of us have neighborhood heroes. Right? Every neighborhood you went to, yo, you know this cat, everybody knew you in your hood, whether it was one block or 20 blocks. So, and the guys like you, right? Guys like him, in his world, in the boogie world, guys like me in my dance world, we don't get the recognition because somebody else took it and they did what they did. But it really started from people like you.
With the simple people like us, you know, just hanging out. Shit just hanging out. You know, like the whole hip-hop movement, before it was even called hip-hop, I was at the show with Henry Chalfant and Martha Cooper when the term hip-hop was coined. When they started calling this hip-hop, it was at the Worcester Gallery. We were doing a thing for Graffiti TV. I had done a canvas for Henry Chalfant. And you know, everybody was there. You had Rocksteady there. You know, the first guys from Rocksteady. You know, Tribiaki was there, Ken Swift was there, Crazy Legs was there, Frosty Freeze, Mr. Freeze, Ramel Z was there. You know, I was there. You know, and if you look at the photos, and this was 1980. Okay, this is when now you gotta understand, this was going on long before 1980. I mean, I'm talking, we're going back to 1975. Mm-hmm. 76, 75, late 75, 76 when breakdancing started, and that started kicking off the whole movement. You know? There's a lot of stuff going on that the gangs, you know, the Ghetto Brothers, and I get it, you know, when that stopped, you know, the gang stopped, there's gang
Yellow Benji,
fucking, Black Benji getting Black killed, Benji, yep. Yellow Benji taking over, mm-hmm. and, you know, bringing peace instead of war, mm-hmm. you know, the documentary Ghetto, Rebel King, you know, that brings it down, and it, you know, and that's pretty good and pretty accurate, but there was still the element where guys like me, you know, we were little kids, man, we were just hanging around and stuff, and when the breakdancing came, my man, this kid Alexander, man, Satch, he's the one that showed me how to breakdance, and it wasn't a lot of stuff, it was just, you know, get on the floor, and, you know.
What was his name?
His name was Alexander, but he went by the name of Satch, because he looked like Satchmo from the East Side, from the Bowery Boys. Remember that TV yep. show, the Bowery Boys? Boys? Yep. Remember? Yep. Satchmo with the big nose, yep. Well, my man Satch, he had that big nose.
Is he still alive?
He's still alive, man.
You know, I recall the name Satch. I recall it.
You know, so he's known. He's known by a lot of people, man. Like my man, what's his name, man? Bomb 5. You know, Bomb he knows him real
well. Yeah, Bomb
5,
yeah.
Well, Bomb 5, you know, and
that's the TBB,
exactly.
I come from Rockwell, which is
okay.
The sister or brother club of TBB.
Okay.
Yeah, because I think that people did a little more than Rockwell.
See, but what I'm talking about is like I'm building a timeline. Yep. You know, because I was doing this in late 75, early 76. You know, and before we were doing it with cardboard. Forget about carpet. Before cardboard, we were doing it on the fucking street. You know.
But let me ask you now. I'm going to interrupt you every now and then just to say, so when you, because I love that you're creating the timeline. When was the first time you remember saying, oh shit, what is that?
When my man Satch, I'm going to say it was 75. When my man Satch came up to me, yo, let's do this. And he has said that it came from Ogden Avenue. Like some people, that was the rumor going around. That it came from Ogden Avenue, some Jamaican guys smoking flips and shit. Because back then it wasn't blunts, it was splits.
They're splits.
You know, and they threw themselves on the floor and stuff. But you know, there was a lot of influence, and people finally took it. You know, and it started in the Bronx, kid, in the boogie down Bronx, man. You know, and when I saw Satch do it, he taught me. He started doing it. You know, and it just like it started becoming real popular. And now you started seeing the music, and it wasn't so much rapping. It was more of an MC.
Right.
At the parties.
Well, they're the ones
that moved the crowd.
Like they were the ones that moved the crowd.
And there wasn't a lot of rapping and stuff like that. You know, Method the Sugar Hill Gang came out.
They weren't even the first ones,
but they were the first ones. Sugar Hill was the first ones to get it on the radio.
Yeah.
They were the first ones to get on the radio, but they weren't the first ones.
No, they weren't.
No, there was, you know, there wasn't much rapping.
I mean,
Spoonie G, AJ, Curtis Blow.
King T the Third, what is
King T?
King T the Third?
I'm bringing in another young lady here.
Yeah.
Her name is Paulette. Paulette was like the secretary / do it all at the Disco Fever.
At the Disco Fever.
Mm. And so she goes further back with this stuff.
Right.
The story's really old.
And that's coming soon.
But when it comes to that part
where it got established and everything, when you started getting these people, because we're talking waiting for the fever, you know, it was just the beginnings of it, the spark that lit the flame that started the culture.
So in 1975, you were
15.
You were 15.
In 75, I was 14.
14. So were you already getting down graph as well?
I was working on King 13 at that time, yeah. I was doing y'all, good. And it's funny because in the neighborhood, you know, they had the gang, the Bronxy Champions. The Bronxy Champions, they had the Flying Dutchman. They had so many gangs. It was ridiculous. Mm-hmm. The Eternal Bachelor. You had the Reapers. You had the Ghetto Brothers. You know, you had the Flying Aces. You had so many fucking.
The Nomads.
Every corner, the Nomads. That's the Nomads. A famous graffiti writer that was up like crazy. DSR from the Savage Nomads, man. He was dope, man.
Did you know C?
C?
Yeah, he used to write C-E.
Oh, the C-E that I know is from Brooklyn.
C-E.
Part of the C-E.
You know, not for nothing, there was a couple of C-E's. Yeah. I'm trying to remember, and these are names that came after. Like, I started writing in 73. Okay. All right, I was King 13. In 77, I became TKid. Not Terrible Kid, like you keep calling me. TKid.
But what?
The Kid. It was short. Because when I was in the Bronx and Chances, I was the youngest guy, but I was tall.
Right.
And they called me Kid. Yo, Kid. And I was skinny, bro. I was real skinny. And we would play, you know, we played football on the block and shit, you know. And I'd be like, yo, throw the ball. And my boys used to laugh at me, yo, look at that big T over there. You know, because I look like a big T in my head and shit, you know. And when I got shot, bro, I was 77, I was in Lincoln Hospital and shit, and my brother had, you know, I was locked up too, man. I had me handcuffed and shit to the bed and shit. And my brother had came to visit me and shit, and he brought me some Buffalo markers, you know, little sketch pad and shit. And I was just doing little bubble ups and throw ups and shit, and I came up with the name Big T and Kid. Big T, T Kid. I was like, oh, that's dope. That's dope. T Kid. And then later on, I added the terrible to it, Terrible T Kid. You know, because the shit that I do is. But that was
well, a it was so nice. It was terrible.
You know?
So let me ask you, I love your timeline. So give me the timeline, like, when was the first time you were introduced to graffiti? And then from graffiti you went to breaking, then you just stayed with the graffiti.
73 I came in graffiti. 73 I came into graffiti. I started King 13, you know. I was influenced by what I saw in the trenches. People was farming the trenches. You know, it wasn't all this elaborate shit you saw like in the late 70s and 80s. You know, but it was the beginnings of it,
yeah,
you know?
Yeah.
And that's, you know, 73 is when I was 12 years old, man. You know, going up to 13 and shit. I got drafted into the game because of fucking tagging on my bodega icebox and shit. They were like, yeah, you tagged me on our turf. You know, and the guy made me an offer I couldn't refuse. It was two or three of them, man. And they were like, yo, come here. Yo, you that dude that does the tricks on the swings. Remember that shit?
Yeah.
I was the best. We were the best.
I wish.
I used to jump over that shit backwards. We used to jump over the fences backwards. Bro, we used to do, you remember the apple turnover? Over the fence, bro. Apple turnover over the fence.
Open up to the bottom. Yeah, trust me, we had that.
Yo, dude, we had this one dude.
Competition of the swings.
His name was Louie, man. Yo, he used to swing so high, he used to wrap himself
on
the swing.
Yeah, we had none that did.
Yo, but he broke off his legs, man, and the ribs, man. What am I doing that shit?
My boy, he was dangerous.
This is how I got into the gangs, and this is how I fucking started writing, you know, King 13, because I was the king of the swings. You know, we had like Noble Park, they came down to battle us. Me, that dude Sad, Louie, you know, a couple of us, and yo, at the end, we ripped these guys because we came up with more tricks than they had, you know. We started doing the apple turnover over the fence.
That's crazy.
Okay,
yeah.
over the fence.
How high was the fence?
The front fence, you had the front fence,
right,
and you had the back fence.
That's what we had.
See, with the apple turnover, you couldn't do it over the big fence.
No, not the big fence.
We would land on top and stand on the pole, bro.
Can we say that swing competition is another element to
it? Right, pretty much.
But this is what's coming out, bro. See all that energy and all that acrobatic and athleticism that we had. It was only natural that breakdancing was created. You know? Oh, what's that, man?
Oh, that's somebody's texting me.
Oh, okay. They're texting
me. And let me tell you why we stopped doing it. This kid Pico, remember, they were metal frames.
Yeah.
He was trying to get away and he lost sight. The corner of the swing went in his head.
Oh.
Dude, he only has half a head.
Oh.
And after that,
he's still alive, bro.
Yeah.
Yo, because they got rid of the swings. Because back in the days, the swings were made out.
We stopped doing it after
that. Yeah, it was a health hazard.
So, but I'm glad you brought that up. We never
brought that up. But see, this is the timeline.
And after that, when
the breakdancing started, man, you know, in 75, I want to say the winter of 75, Sash came over, yo, we got to check. And I remember we was in my apartment, my father's apartment, in the living room, and he was throwing himself on the floor. And I remember I threw myself on the floor, and I just started helping the floor. He's like, yo, that's dope, we got to do that. You know, and then we started doing the helicopter, like, oh shit, swinging the leg around. Those were the only moves, you know, you went down and you fucking did the little moves like that. There weren't power moves, there weren't no swipes, there were no flares, there were no power there was none of that at the beginning.
Same thing with Rocky.
So exactly. You know, and then all of a sudden you started seeing in the school, I remember Kieran, James Kieran's 123, which was over in the corner of Bruckner and I got, I want to say Morrison. Down from Watson Avenue.
I remember seeing
Cool Herc coming down. You know? Cool Herc and Shaka Zulu, you know, and all this stuff. Like you start seeing all this, man. You know? And this was after the games, after the thing with Benji, with Black Benji getting killed. You know, Bambaataa taking his chapter of the black space and converting it into the Zulu nation. You know?
So Bambaataa was a black spade, or was he a baby spade?
He was a baby spade. They had a chapter in the Project, they were projects, mm-hmm. and he took that, and after they had that meeting and all that stuff, and you know, there was a rumor, I remember as a kid hearing that it was a black spade who had killed Benji, Black Benji, but you know, we don't know. Well, I don't know, that was a rumor I heard. I don't even know how true that is. It might just be bullshit.
My boy Will, his name is Marine Boy Willie. He was an Imperial Bachelor.
Okay.
Warlord.
Yeah.
He wrote two books. I haven't read it.
Okay, so then you would know what I mean.
Yeah, he knows the whole thing.
So was it the Black Spade?
It's in the book.
It's in the book. We ain't writing anything.
You have to read the book.
But anyway, this is all part of the thing growing up in the Bronx back in the days, and this culture being developed. You know, and
then, but you know what happened in Brooklyn too?
Of course it happened.
We piggybacked off each other.
Pretty much.
You know, this rock.
Listen, not for nothing. You gotta remember, back in those days, there wasn't a lot of communication between the boroughs.
Nope.
But when it came to the fucking movement, the culture, the breakdancing, the uprocking, and all that stuff, the graffiti, there was. That's how everything. So it was only natural. Like, I would fucking write and go to Brooklyn and, you know, we bring what we did, Brooklyn will come up, bam, and fucking bring what they bring. You know, that's how it was.
That the way we learned different dances, and if you were from Brooklyn, you didn't go to the Bronx unless you knew somebody.
Exactly. I remember coming down here to East New York back in the 70s, dude. It was like, yo, you get killed.
Yeah.
You would get killed. Same thing, if you were from Brooklyn and you went back to the South Bronx, you was going to get killed.
So the only way we got away with that, the way we picked up the Bronx culture that I remember, I always say, as I've said before, is Primo de Fulano came in the summer. You know, this summer, oh shit, yo, this is my cousin from the Bronx.
That's
and
right.
He brought a flavor that we
That's
never
right.
saw.
That's right.
And it went the same way that we would, you know, somebody would go to the Bronx.
And that kind of happened with us.
That's what happened with us, yeah.
You know, like, I never saw loft dance in my life. I didn't know what, I had no idea what the hell. I'm still learning about it, put it that way. But I saw him and his boys doing it.
Right.
And I'm like, okay, I've never saw that before. The baggy pants and all that.
That was style, in Central Park.
That style.
See, that's another thing. The fun over there by the band show. By the band show. The fun.
We were before Boogie Guys came out.
Right.
Boogie Guys came out 2 years later.
Yeah.
And that's when I was already, I see him and some other cats and I'm like, dude, what the fuck is that? Because I never saw, you know, a way, you know, we were dancers.
Right.
When I saw these guys doing bad, 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 where I was like, and I went up to him when he stopped dancing, I said, yo, my man, how the fuck do you do that? He goes, what do you mean? I said, how do you do that with that? And then he showed me, I go, bro, I have to learn this, bro.
Yo, my boy, Tudro, man, he was dope with that shit, with that electric boogie pop lock, all that. He used to do things with the cigarette.
I did the cigarette.
When did you hear popping? When was the first time you heard popping?
The word popping. The word popping was more like late 80s. I mean, not late 80s, late 1980. Late 1980 is when we started hearing pop. And then we heard pop locking. You know, and the popping was just like that, boom, you know? You gotta understand, we have Mr. Wiggles up in the Bronx, okay? And Mr. Wiggles was like, you know, I knew him from 1970.
But Wiggles was a second generation. He didn't start it.
I don't know. All I know is the first generation, but not original.
Like, he's not the one that invented
I don't know.
I don't say he invented it, but I know he was there, man. He was there.
I don't know about and first, second, was, like, man, was, that's
was, but see, the way I know him was in like the late 1980s, after the term
hip hop
was coined by Martha Cooper and Henry
Chopper. When you say late 1980,
83, 84. No, when I say late 1980, the year itself, going into 81. Like, I want to say, after the summer, sometime between September and December.
Oh, okay. That's when we did portfolio.
You know, that's when I started hearing something about, you know, pop locking.
Okay, no, I'm just...
It actually was popping. I mean, locking, that shit came from the West Coast.
Right.
You know, that shit came from the West Coast. And that, was way later.
So
I want to say that's like fucking 84, 85 and shit.
Locking, well, I heard of it before because of the lockers on TV.
Okay.
This was in the 70s.
Right.
Mid-70s. They were already on the...
Check it out. You know, there's a famous clip on, it's on YouTube, okay? It's, and it shows you, you know, they label it on YouTube as the original pop locking or up rockers. Playboy, remember when Hugh Hefner had the show on TV? Remember that show, Channel 9, late at night? He had these guys, man, from down South Atlanta or something. And it's on YouTube, and they're doing this whole up rock shit. And we're talking in the 60s, because that's when they had the show. In the 60s.
Now, from where? They were from where?
They were from down south.
Down south. And so I brought that to his attention, a lot of people's attention.
Yo, that's on YouTube. That's on the Playboy channel, on the Playboy show. Mm-hmm. Midnight show, they used to do a midnight in New York, it was a Channel 9 at midnight. And we're talking in 1968,
right.
I think it was.
So with the big argument, the East Coast, West Coast, Brooklyn, Bronx, they always exclude the South. And I always say,
People don't know that, you know, it was just a mixture. Yeah, James, I mean, the way they danced, the way James Brown fucking brought it down, come on, man.
Now,
look at pop locking and all that stuff,
Boogie, one of my first shows, first time they put me on a stage and gave me a few dollars, right? Was a gay club.
Okay.
It was a gay club, and Wanda was a leader of the Mexican crew, and she was a lesbian. Okay. And she goes, I got something for you. And she took me to this gay club on Tremont Avenue near Grand Concourse. Oh, it was Burnside.
Oh, great. No.
But you used to go there too, huh?
No. It was on 192nd in the Grand Concourse, right up from Fordham Road. I forgot the name of it, and it was like the spot that we used to make fun of. Like, if you got caught in there,
right.
You know, you was...
So Wanda...
Back in those days, you used to get labeled and shit, unfortunately.
Right. So,
it's not like today.
So Wanda took me in there, and that's the first time I ever saw what they called a dry queen, you know, which is a transsexual today.
No, a man dressed like a woman.
Yeah. So the first time I ever saw that, and they were performing, and she throws me up there, and I did electric boogie. I was like, pull my fist. And then, you know, she pulled me off the stage, gave me like $100 and said, all right, get the hell out of here. And she kicked me out.
She said,
and that was really my first,
club,
that was my first,
show me that there, really.
That was my first performance ever.
Really?
You know, and they
should be proud, man.
But I'm just saying, a little secret that, you know,
I'm trying to remember what the name was, because it was popular, believe it or not, man. I lived right down the block from there. You know, back in 1978, I was giving up in Yonkers after I got shot, man. You know, my father disowned me. He moved, you know, from Boynton Avenue in the Bronx. He moved to Yonkers, right? And so I used to go up there to hang out with my brother. You know, after a while, my father forgave me, so I started hanging out and living up there. You know, between the Bronx, my mother's house and my father's house in Yonkers. My mother lived in 192nd and Aqueduct in the Bronx. My father was living up in fucking Randolph Avenue in Yonkers, right? And met this kid, right? So I developed, that's when I started my crew, the TMB crew, the Nasty Boys, right? Now, this is 77, right? And in 78, I already had a crew, Mike Dust, Pessa, Anthony the Rock, this kid named Stone, Joker One, right? And there was this kid that was always hanging, a black kid that used to hang out with, his name was Donnie, right? And he was cool, you know, he was one of the guys and shit, man. So it was his birthday in 1978, I want to say around September or so, right? And we go down to 77th Street or 87th Street in Amsterdam Avenue, right? And we go in this club, right? And it's early. You see, we were celebrating his birthday, so it's me, Mike Dust, my brother, you know, this kid, Angus, and Donald, right? And we're in there, and I'm like all excited, like waiting for the DJ to come come in when the girls are popping off and shit like that, you know? And this is the day that homeboy decided to come out. You know? So you know, I got my experience with shit like that. You know? But the funny thing is, it was like, yo, that's our boy, Donald. That's Donald. You know?
Well, what are you gonna do?
It's like, yo, what the fuck, man? You know, who cares?
We always had, there was always one.
Yeah, yeah.
There was always one that was either undercover.
So,
but it was funny. You had to be there, man. Because the look on me and my brother's face, like, when people started coming, it was all guys, and I'm telling my boy Mike Dust, I'm like, yo, where the girls at? And apparently he knew, right? And I'm like, yo, where the girls at? And all of a sudden the DJ showed up, and I saw the guys get up and dancing. And that's when I realized, where the fuck, me and my brother, we like, we do this shit. Yo, you're so clever, we had the hood. Getting the fuck out of there and shit. We were hoping nobody saw us when we came out the club and shit, man.
But I'm gonna say, listen, like, some of the earliest platforms that was open to the culture of breakdancing, electric boogie, was the gay clubs. And you remember Plato's Retreat? We used to perform in Plato's Retreat.
You know what closed down?
Those were the
days. AIDS.
AIDS
closed down those clubs.
Yeah.
Because I used to work at Genesis.
But they opened the doors. The punk rock.
I was at security.
No, I'm sorry, but also the punk rock brought us in there also. So,
punk rock is a shit, man. We used to go down to CBGB's back in the day.
Yep. Oh, yeah. Right, Bowery Room, CBGB.
Bowery
Room. Coney Island High. Shit. All those clubs. Dude, I was a bouncer. I worked in all of them.
Nice.
I worked in all those clubs.
Yo, I remember, man. Let me see Danceteria. That was one of the Paradise Garage, Danceteria. The Palladium. Downstairs.
I worked at the Miners Todd Room.
Then we had
ones. We have Bonds International.
Gotham's West was on 92nd.
No, Gotham's West was near Hudson and.
Okay. That
I
was,
would say.
You know what? Gotham's West is where fucking Keith Haring got me in for free.
Gotham's West.
Yeah, Gotham West. Man.
So Broadway 96.
Broadway. That's what I was thinking. Broadway, but that changed name.
Yeah, Broadway 96.
It was first
Latin Quarters.
It was first. Broadway 96.
Then Latin.
The Ball Busters used to hang out there.
That was their club.
The Ball Busters used to hang out there, and I had beef with them at the time. Yeah. It's funny.
Everybody had beef with them.
Listen, we was painting today up in the Bronx. We was painting up in the Bronx and shit. You know, I had this crew called TBS, and we were at war with the Ball Busters. We started that shit, man. So I'm painting in the Bronx today, right? And this guy, Baby Rock from the Ball Busters. We're the best of friends now, man. The dude is so fucking cool. I wish I would.
He was young and stupid.
I wish I would have got to know him back then. But who he really is? Because the dude is a mad cool brother. You know, and it's fucked up because actually it was my boy Shock 123, you know, who started that whole war with the Ball Busters. Because, you know, we was up on Dykeman one time and this kid Sid 137 just came up, said hi to me, gave me a pound, and my man Shock just snuffed him for no reason. And that started that whole. Now what am I supposed to do? Yeah. Man, Shock's my boy. You know? So that's why
Ball Busters had beef. I remember them having
beef. I remember one time there was a Ball Buster that showed up in Pole Park, where you used to hang out, Pole Park, and we're talking 1983, 82, 83.
That was HBO right there. Right? And so
this Ball Buster, yo, we fucking chased them all around the fucking block to record. We beat them on the corner of one night, where the gay club was at, down the block. We beat them right in the corner over there.
They always came to
Bonds International.
Bonds International always beat them and the Cowboys. Cowboys always had trouble too. Yep. But anyway, now get back to you real quick. So, you started writing in 73, you said. 73,
I was a neighborhood bomber and shit. Right? In 77, I became TKid.
So then TKid. Right. Now, did you ever do full murals outside the cars, or you were just bombing? Were you considered a bomber, or you did?
No, I was a style writer. I was burning my shit in a car on the outside of the car. I mean, I bombed the insides for a little bit. You know, in my beginnings was all about inside motion tagging and shit like that.
With the unis, with the fucking pilots, with the shoe polish. You get the band-aid box, you get the eraser, you take the eraser, you fold it, put ink, and then get that drip and fucking tag. Yeah, dude, come on, man, we used to do that shit, man. You know? But
I was more like, when I became TKid, that's what I was doing pre-TKid. You know, in 7102 and King 13, that's what I was bombing neighborhoods and insides and shit like that, and mostly windows, because the panels were all taken, man, you know? And I was like, you know what, I want to do the outside, because the outsides was like, that's where the shit was, man. That's where the dope shit was. And I was really attracted by colors and style of letters, and I wanted to do that.
So that's yours, that's yours.
My, you know, dude, I painted everywhere. At first, I started in the 1 yard, okay? My first piece actually was in a layup between Morris and what the fuck? Noble was the next street, man? Noble, on the 6th line. Morrison was the stop, and the next stop, St. Lawrence. That was the next, they had a layup one night, and I remember going there to do a King 13. I wanted to go bombing inside King 13, and I couldn't fucking get inside. They had the doors locked, they were all locked. So I had this fucking pilot full of ink, and I did my first throw up with a fucking pilot on the outside of the thing.
Bubble letters.
And I'm doing King with this fucking thing, and when I got to the fucking eyes, it started going dry.
So you used to do it in the middle of the tracks there?
Like, in the middle of the tracks.
Yeah,
the train would come, and you would get under the train. You would get under the train, or if you was close enough to the end, you climb in the end, and the train just go back. You know? So, you know, that was my first piece, and that was King 13. Now we're talking 1974 when I did that.
You know, then after all of that?
Not that, man. That was
my
later on shit, yeah. I didn't start, yo, not for nothing. I started buying TKid in 77. I didn't really start taking pictures till like 1978, like late 78. And I started, because I was always just about writing. I didn't think about it.
You had one away camera?
Yeah, but the yards, right?
Like, I had the 126, the click.
But remember like the Futuras, the Dundies, the Lee. That was 80s, early 80s.
Right? Donnelly was painting since like, I want to say, I noticed him in 79.
But I'm saying like those
Futura, not for nothing, Futura. Futura was painting from like 76, 77, but they were, him and Ali were doing the inside.
Right.
Futura didn't start doing the outside. The outsides, I want to say the late, like 75 to 76.
Serious? That early?
Yeah, you started seeing more shit, but it didn't start developing style-wise until later on. You know, you started seeing the big bubble letters, you started seeing cliffs with the characters, the Tracy 168s with the characters, you started seeing names with bubble clouds and shit, man. You know, that was all new. That's now you start seeing that shit.
That's 10 hours of work.
Man. You used to go in there with a fat cat. You'd be in there now.
Yeah, but I thought about the pieces that I saw. I remember the Christmas pieces, right? The
Christmas pieces?
Bro, all those pieces.
That probably took me like 2 hours, man.
Are you joking?
I'm not kidding, bro.
You can't do that in two hours.
Yeah, the letters were so simple, and you know, one guy would draw the character, and the guy would help fill in. If you had a good partner, and you was both working together,
I used to get, listen,
you know, I see some of the whole cars I did, man, like the breakdance car I did. That shit took 3 hours, man. We went in the yard 3 hours. It was me, you know, and I outlined everything. I had this guy come to fill in over here, that guy filling over there.
We got helpers?
We helped each other, bro. That's how it was.
See, the Brooklyn guys are going to do that. It was one cat trying to fill it.
That's what the crews were all about, man. You know, you had your guys, like my boys, man, Professor, Race. I used to do the outlines, they come in and they start filling in.
So when you have a crew like that, right, who says, well, today we're going to do...
We would be sitting down smoking weed in somebody's house, listening to some fucking breakdance music, beats, mostly beats, yeah, you know. We were listening to beats, smoking weed and shit, talking about, yo, let's do this. And we were like, yeah, you know, let's... And it was never about just one name, because whenever I did a car, it was TKid, Pessa, Race, you know, I would do the outlines first, and then we would do like characters, like the Cops and Robber cap train we did, the Howard the Duck playing the guitar with the disco dancer.
Cars like that,
bro, we used to fucking do, man, you know, and I used to come up and we would sit down and brainstorm, and then we would look at the colors, we would be sitting there with our little fucking out of the color pencils or the fucking Buffalo markers. We color in and figure it out, and then on a Saturday morning, we fucking head down to the
But how do you pick, like, today we're going to do your name, next week we're going to do his name?
No, it was never just one name. It was a bunch of names.
So you took a whole car.
A whole car, window down, or a whole car top to bottom, you know? So it was like how much paint we had. So it was like that, because, you know, it was about all of us.
And that's true, too.
We used to rack up a lot.
Yeah, oh, we used to rack up like crazy.
Where'd you go?
In Manhattan, Wolf's Paint, all the fucking Martin's paints, all the fucking Woolworths.
Like, by the way, I'm gonna skip this part.
Pergaments. Yo, Woolworth.
I forgot about Woolworth.
Channel Lumber. Yo, we used to Fox Hardware.
You didn't hit Sears?
Sears, we hit everything. Alexander, Bodegas used to have spray paint, bro. Bodegas, man. You go to the paint where they sell paint, like Pittsburgh paints. you would go to fucking Sherman Williams, and you would fucking they had all kind of paint.
You never got busted?
Well, racking up in Jersey, man. We were doing money racks, because after a while it was about, you know, let's make money. So we would go stealing Sherlings and shit like that. And we got busted, but we got away anyway, man.
Did you ever get chased out of the yard?
I got chased. I got shot at. I got caught 3 times by the cops. I got my head cracked open 1 time. Somebody hit me. I don't know who it was. Then I didn't go down. They disappeared.
You remember when they had the conductors at the patty?
Yeah, that fucking shit. The conductor shit.
Yeah,
we used to crack people's head with that shit all the time, bro.
Yeah.
That was the shit, man. But yeah, man, that's how it was, man. That's how it was. And this was the whole culture developing. So, you know, the culture included not just breakdancing. It was about the graffiti.
Yeah,
it was about the style of clothes we was wearing.
Of course.
The fat shoelaces. You know, the bell bottoms with the graffiti on the side. The loose jackets.
Dude, I had that. We all had that.
The Caesar haircuts. Yeah, the Chino pants. Yep, and the marshmallows. The Ritz.
It was a whole
lot. Yeah, it was the culture, it was the clothing, the style of clothing, the music we listened to, the MCing, the breakdancing, the graffiti. It was a cultural, artistic movement. It wasn't just visual art, the graffiti. It was also the physical art, the dancing, the uprock, the breakdancing, everything included.
We're getting electric boogie, man.
You know?
Yeah, but let's not talk about those. So let me ask you another question. So here it is, mid-80s, right? Early mid-80s. What did you do? Did you retire? Or did you start doing galleries?
At that time, no. See, I always stood away from the galleries at that time because I was like against it. I was underground. I was hardcore. And I always felt that galleries was a cellar. And, you know, I was still wild, man. I still had a lot of shit in me that I had to work out, man. You know, and the way I worked it out was by vamping and vicking and all that kind of shit, man, you know? And I didn't really get into the galleries till now. Later on in life.
So did you retire at some point?
Yeah. No. Well, I stopped. I stopped there because I got this woman pregnant. I had a son. You know.
Right. And what year was that?
My son was born in '85. She had gotten pregnant in '84.
So you stopped in '84.
So I kind of slowed down. I kind of slowed down. I slowed down a lot. Like, okay, now I'm doing maybe 2 cars a year. You know, and it's funny because I remember doing a car with Tracy and Scene in 1985 after my son was born.
Scene became a good graffiti. He became a tattoo artist. Big tattoo artist.
Yeah, he was a big tattoo guy.
Yep.
You know, me and him got a little beef, but I'm not going to get into that. That's all bullshit.
So there's 2 Scenes, right?
Yeah, Black Scene, Rupert, he was there today at this rock.
So there was a big beef between them too. I remember that.
No, the other scene, the black scene was the original scene.
Right, one came in and took it.
And this guy just came out of nowhere and
took it.
You know, got famous and got more famous than the other scene.
Yeah, but he also did a lot more as far as being seen.
No
pun intended.
Absolutely. Yeah. But there's a reason why he was able to do that. You know, I'm not going to get into
I'm not going to put no race cards into this.
Exactly. Well, that and more, you know, having the right connection, the right people, you know, when it came to the, you know. So, you know, that he got famous that way. But yeah, man, listen, man, it's not even about that. I didn't get into the galleries till later on. Back then I stood underground. I slowed down big time. Then I started working for the city of New York. And I started in '84. So now I had a good paying job. I was a painter and stuff. And it was time to, you know, be trying to be a family man. I was trying to be responsible. But I was also struggling with cocaine addiction at the time, too.
I was there for about a year and a half.
So it took me till 1990 to get locked up, almost losing everything and shit, man, for me to finally stop, you know. And that's what it took, man. That's what it took.
Yeah, but God bless you, bro.
But after, when I came back, like in, you know, in 1990, I started painting walls. Pretty much the train movement was gone. And it sucked because it wasn't the same. You know, it wasn't the same shit. It was like, all right, let's paint walls. and you know, we get in, do these big productions and stuff, and you know, it's cool.
Yeah, but now you're I'm not knocking down for it.
Not, yeah, oh, well, of course.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
You know, I'm not knocking it and stuff, but it wasn't the same feeling like fucking going
it
out.
It never is.
Fucking...
Listen, like when we danced in Central Park, when he danced, bro, you can never go back to that. So you have to try to find a way to, and flow with the evolution of it, right?
Yeah.
Which in your case, as well as dancers, was to go make money now. Open up galleries, do walls.
Well, you know, I have a saying, and I tell people, especially when you start making money, now they start calling you a sellout. I'm like, oh, listen, stop me right there. But stop me right there, okay? I gave away enough free shit, okay? I done got chased for this. I done got beaten for this. I done got locked up for this, okay? I got shot, stabbed for this shit, all right? Now I'm gonna get mine. It's time for me to get paid. All right, now I'm gonna get paid. Okay, it's real simple. And at the same time, guess what? At the same time, at my age, I'm still active. I'm still painting with the neighborhood guys. I love to meet new writers. All right, my man Steve over here. This is such a prolific. You know, he found me in Puerto Rico. You know, and painting with him, I've learned so much. No, he's from Puerto Rico. My man from Carolina, man.
So he was writing graffiti in Puerto Rico.
Yeah, Puerto Rico. He's one of the first graffiti writers from Puerto Rico, bro. Yo, man, you gotta read his book when it comes out, man. Yo, I saw the.
Yeah, and you have a book too.
Yeah, I have a book too. Yeah.
So.
It's out now.
It's out of print now, man. It's going for like 200 a pop if you can
really?
Find it.
Wow.
Yeah, man.
Okay.
So you know.
So it's got more stuff than what you're telling us, right?
It's got everything. Everything that I'm telling you, plus more, you know? Mm-hmm. So, you know, and I go through the whole thing, man, you know, and it's 30 years of my life in one book, you know, and it's really amazing, man, you know? But like I said, man, you know, now it's about getting paid and it's about giving back too, because not only that, I also like to do workshops with kids and stuff and talk to them about graffiti and how to express themselves positively through art, through graffiti art, you know? Or
it's
whatever. It's really about finding yourself. What is it you like to do? Some people want to dance. They want to freaking pop.
'74.
Electric boogie.
In 74. Thank you. 74, 75, right?
There was
did you
none
think,
of that shit.
Did you no. think you'd be like, you know, selling paintings and doing art galleries and writing a book and
shit,
all this other stuff?
In 74, I was hoping I wasn't going to get killed by the freaking gangs and hoping I wouldn't end up dead like everybody else.
Yeah, but did you ever think of yourself as an artist? Because graffiti...
Not until now.
That's funny, because listen, I did graffiti. We all did it.
Yeah.
Listen, everything we talk about, probably 90% of us did it because there were no computers, no phones, so we did it. But I never said... I remember getting into fights over the word toy. You're a toy.
Yeah.
you wrote over somebody's name by accident, even if it was one dude. And I was like, I can never get into that stuff because of that shit. I was like, dude, it's bad enough I'm fighting gang wars out here with people, what neighborhood you're going, now I'm going to fight about my dancing, then I got to fight about the rock, then I got to fight about the graffiti. That, bro, everything we did became, like you said, a battle.
Yeah.
It didn't matter. The swings, you battled. Graffiti, you battled. You know, if you play...
Roller skating, it was a battle.
Dude, if you play Skelly's, it was a battle with another neighborhood. Everything in New York City... Everything we did was a battle, though. It shows you that in the 60s and 70s, we grew up with such a fucking gang mentality.
You know?
Everything we did, and I got beat up. You had to be a gangster.
You had your boys,
bro. You know, you roller skate, dude. I remember the roller skate. I was a freestyle roller, right?
You went with your boys.
Because if not, you run into this motherfucker with his Brooklyn boys.
Right. And so check this out. We were doing it on wheels, freestyle rollers. Go to Fort Hamilton, get into a brawl. Go to dance. What's the other one? Dance Fever? No, I forgot the other big one we used to go to. Dude, every time. Just because you're dancing, you got into a fight with Badines, bro. Fucking Badines.
Crazy shit.
Dude, everything
that's how it was. That's how it was.
How
about Tops? You ever play Tops?
Yeah. Tops.
Don't. What? Yo, yeah. You used to try to crack the other top. Come on, dude.
You hit it.
Come on.
And, we had the pleasure of having you here, bro. I know he's got a 2.5-hour drive back to the farm where he's almost killed me in traffic. So we gotta wrap it up. You know, hopefully we could get some of his pieces and post this, you know, put it on a program. Eventually, if he does, I'll more mural. We want to do that, but.
If somebody wants to contact you, is there like a contact they can contact?
Absolutely, you can find me on TKid17 on Instagram. So just at TKid17, TKID170. And you can also reach me, man, at TKid17@gmail.com.
And you're doing mural. So if somebody wants to do a graph piece of, bro, I just saw these pieces that him and this guy did in Puerto Rico. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So if anybody wants this guy, if anybody, you know, these guys are still working, brothers, support them. Bro, these guys are no joke. This guy's 78 years old. How old are you?
78 years old. That's funny. Bro. Well, first, what you showed was my man's work. That wasn't my work. That's my man's work. You know, but we, you know, I do that stuff too. And no, I'm not 78 years old, bro.
You look a day over 70.
You know, thank God, bro, because I feel like this. But you know, but now, man, all kidding aside, man, this is what we do, man. You know, it's about creating art, man. You know, trying to make the world a better place today, man. And we do it all kind of ways, man. Through dancing, through expressing ourselves, doing things like this, man.
And spread it to the kids, bro.
You know, and letting everybody know, man. You know, we can all get together, man. I mean, come on, Brooklyn, Bronx, you know what I'm saying? I don't know.
Boogie down Bronx, bro. 137
Cypress
Avenue, baby.
We're on the 3rd.
If you haven't heard,
180 Avenue, Rockwell. Yo, this is my man, Ski Man, and he said, one of the first graffiti artists.
De los que empezó.
Bueno, me puse catalio, pero mi mamá de Carolina.
De los primeros que empezó eso ayer. Empezó en el 81. Empezó con eso del baile.
¿Cómo vas a hacer el tributo también?
Yo hacía todo eso. Yo bailaba en el piso.
En el 81 yo fui el que empecé el primer grupo de Electric Boogie.
En Puerto Rico.
En Jordan Torres.
Ahí estaba Jancy,
Eddie, David.
Estaba el que se movió este.
Yo estoy haciendo algo ahora con Jancy. Pero mira, Jancy es un DJ now.
Él estaba así.
Pero yo hice algo con Jancy en Llorén Torres.
Sí.
Y ellos abrieron el grupo mío TMF en Llorén. Y no sé si usted se recuerda, la primera comercial en Puerto Rico que era breakdancing de 7-Up.
Sí,
que sacó el teatro, ese era yo.
Que se murió.
Pero ese era yo. Ese soy yo. Doing the breakdancing.
Estaba Alex Dick.
It played all over the theaters.
Alex Dick Coquit también. Que era más de locking.
Yo hice el show de las 12. El show de Ir Chacón. Yo hice todo ese show.
Yo hacía la escenografía de ellos también.
So you know, Jancy.
Jancy, ese es él.
Well, Jancy, I let him open up The Magnetic Force, which was the name of my group, and Jordan Torres in 1980.
Oye, y el Pache, ese Pache tuyo?
Sí.
Oh, yeah.
The Amazing Ski.
It's awesome, bro. I like it, man.
Sí.
Your work is amazing. Yep, it is.
That's right. It's amazing.
It's amazing.
Yo, again, bro.
My pleasure, man.
Gracias por estar aquí. Thank you for coming, bro.
Thank you for having us.
Listen, we all summer long, bro. We do other stuff besides this.
Right.
This is over.